All right, starting again. Sorry for those who had to go through that. Today, welcome back. Today is Thursday, May 12, Class 4. Teachings of Weibu Sayadaw from the translation from the Burmese by Roger Bischoff in the book called The Essential Practice, and compiled by U Tle Klein. I really don't know how to pronounce Burmese words. U Tle Klein, collector of some of the discourses. Last time, finished the introduction, 7 points, and started into first chapter called What Really Matters. I'm quite keenly aware of my inferiority to Weibu Sayadaw, and so I beg your understanding that, in some ways it's inappropriate for me to be sharing or presuming that I can understand what he's saying. A little I think I do, but this is a very serious practitioner and a very different kind of approach than many of the other teachers that I've worked from or gave series of, like Nityananda, Nisargadatta, the Sutta Nipata raw material, Heraclitus, because here is a set of teachings from a man for whom practice was life, and life was practice, and what was essential to his life was practice, and it seems he made final attainment, and his teaching puts practice first. So the book called The Essential Practice, it could also be understood as practice is essential, or practice as essential, the essential primacy of practice. And I'm not perfect in any way, and he's apparently near perfect in most ways, or it seems. And he's not talking about, the freedom of enlightenment, like demonstrating the freedom of enlightenment or the essentials from a completely transcendent condition like Nityananda, or working through confusions of wrong view, moving to non-duality like Nisargadatta, or philosophical, pearls here and there of Heraclitus, or very E.T., slow, multidimensional, not at all quite non-dual approach from the raw material. This is a serious practitioner. And when I say, go straight or don't stop. This go straight or maximal effort, he's really an embodiment of maximal effort in practice. And this is a certain category of practitioner in Buddhism that I don't see much. You don't see much in Hinduism, or I haven't seen much. There are, I assume, yogis like that. But this type of straight arrow Buddhist practitioner, embodies the best of ardent seeking. And I'm nothing like that. So, I have to just put that out here at the beginning. And so you see that, I see that in him following the breath, recommending the following your breath all day long. When you're sitting, standing, walking, lying down, follow the breath. Okay, well, it's not very practical living in the world, but that shows the degree of ardent practice, ardent mindfulness, discipline that is Weibu Sayadaw. So I'm going to try to move quickly through the many paragraphs and essence teachings of the chapter, What Really Matters. In the first chapter, he's saying, you've taken up moral code, Shila. Now that you've undertaken to perfect yourselves in morality, fulfill it to the utmost. Only if you fulfill morality to the utmost will all your aspirations be met. you'll be happy now and in the future. And as I said before, this is the link between morality and the karmic basis of fulfilling desires. All your aspirations include the aspirations that he himself has no interest in, such as aspiring to happiness in either the celestial or human or celestial worlds. Point number 4 of the 7 in the introduction. He's saying aspire to none but Nibbana. Meanwhile, we do aspire and long for some happiness in the human and celestial worlds, meaning higher dimensions. And, you know, mainly Rupa Loka. And yet, this is the principle. And so, the stronger the morality, which really means blamelessness, full, complete blamelessness in thought, word, and deed. Not simply right speech, right action, right livelihood, but a real commitment to right effort where we recognize the harm that may be and we avoid it. We recognize the harm we've taken up and drop it. We recognize the good that we haven't adopted and adopt it. We recognize the good that we have and perfected or cultivated. So it may be very serious discipline. So discipline is what's on offer here. Yet morality as a wish-fulfilling gem, in a sense. You want to fulfill your wishes, go to morality. And of course you can't do, you know, you can't do morality to get the immoral. But it happens, you know? It's like Richard Gere, right? I'm sure Richard Gere was a Tibetan Lama in some past life. I imagine. Or even Steven Seagal, right? So these guys are not saintly yogis at this lifetime, but in my view, these guys are probably Tibetan Lamas of some degree in some past lives. And they thought, I don't want to sit here in the craggy mountains of Tibet. I want to sing and dance. So then they became born as celebrities in the West. And so when they finish with that, they'll go back to a different, you know, more enlightenment-focused aspiration, perhaps. And so, okay, morality is critical. Shila goes to samadhi, goes to prajna, and there's no other way, actually. Certainly to complete and perfect awakening. The basis has got to be morality. And the basis of well-being, emotional, psychological well-being, too. So then he said, nothing but the teachings of the Buddha can give you real happiness in the present and the remainder of samsara. And maybe you can say the principles of Buddha Dhamma teachings, which is what? Shila, Samadhi, Prajna? Yeah, pretty important. And so we have a nice droning grass cutting outside that might reduce the sound a bit. It's an important comment or statement where he's saying that the essence of the Tipitaka as the 37 factors of awakening, which maybe I'll do at the end of this first chapter. I mean, this whole discussion could take months. It might go for a year, the discussion of the full book, The Essential Practice on Weibo Sayadaw, because it's really a summary of essential Buddhism or the essential principles of Buddhism that lead to transformation. So if you take the essence of the Tipitaka, we find 37 factors of awakening. Essence of that being the Eightfold Noble Path, the essence of that being threefold training. And that's where you get Shila, Samadhi, Prajna. And he used the word Adi. So Adi Shila, Adi Prajna, or Adi Samadhi, Adi Panya. Higher, more Shila, Samadhi, Prajna. And the essence of that is the One Dhamma, or Universal Law, which is really the Universal Law of how to transform a 7-chakra, 7-dimensional being in the octave to be finished with the need for incarnation in the octave. So then, and the other point that I made last week, that As Shila develops higher morality, Adi Shila, higher morality, which is really harmlessness, which comes out as right speech, right action, right livelihood. You know, and we're not, I'm not a saint, so, you know, I don't claim anything. Don't let that ever come out. Don't ever imagine I'm claiming any attainment at all or any development at all. But I think I know a little, and so you do too. We all do. As Shila grows, roughness and harshness decline, subsiding roughness and harshness. This is a very subtle view, and I think you ought to consider it. Saying, he wrote, or he spoke, as if morality becomes strong, Shila, mind becomes peaceful and tranquil, loses its harshness. And so higher morality as more than simply right speech, right action, right livelihood, but a guarding of the mental process and speech and action very carefully. Then, because it's really going beyond even the roughness of emotionalism, the roughness of carelessness or being inattentive, that there's a certain roughness to being all over the place in mind activity. Then, so as that Shila, as Shila goes to Adi Shila, not simply speech and behavior, but mind process, mind states, harmonizing itself, harmonizing mind states themselves. That goes to Adi Shila. So Shila goes to Adi Shila, and Adi Shila goes to, he said, Adi Chitta. And so that's like Chitta as mind awareness. He calls that normally it goes Shila Samadhi Prajna, but here he's showing Adi Shila, Adi Chitta, Adi Panya. So Shila Samadhi Prajna or Panya, the middle. Rather than she or samadhi, he's talking about Adi Shitta, higher mind. Also, he's calling it concentrated mind. So peaceful and tranquil, equanimity, shamatha. So higher mind is more than, is sort of a stabilizing of samadhi. So high development of morality, going to Adi Shila by practice, goes to through samadhi, concentration, you know, samadhi, which is calm abiding as a result of concentration, leads to a relatively stable equanimity. And then that's called a strong mind, a concentration that's strong. Concentration doesn't only mean I'm looking at one point on the wall and I can't change my view. It means that the mind is quiet. And wherever there's a focus, the focus can be steady and sustained. This is, you know, really, this is all Adi training, meaning higher level of training. This is a guy who basically stayed in meditation most of his life. And his teachings come out of that. A really serious commitment to concentration. So concentration becomes strong. This guy knows about concentration. And that's a great freedom from roughness and harshness. Because it's not, there's a phrase in the I Ching, brightness without glare. This sort of adichitta is a brightness of mind without glare. The brightness is attentiveness and presence, high present. Present momentness, you know, present awareness or attentiveness in the present moment, with a great capacity for concentration to direct attention here or there and stay on it or with it or know it. Then he's saying, and this is the first sort of esoteric point he's made, or what seems esoteric to me. If concentration becomes strong and the mind stays one-pointed for a long time, then you realize that in a split second, matter arises and dissolves billions and billions of times. Now, what does that mean? He explains it a little, but not at length. He said, if mind knows matter, it knows that matter originates and disintegrates billions and billions of times in the wink of an eye. This knowledge of arisal, meaning arising, and disintegration is called higher wisdom. This Adipanya, or the third training, you know, Shila Samadhi Prajna, Prajna is Sanskrit, Panya is Pali, higher wisdom, I think is not only this, but includes this. This is understanding the first the three marks, particularly anicca-anatta, impermanence and insubstantiality or no self. Knowing that that the mind process or mind experience is of continual, the experience of continual arising and disintegration is impermanence. But if you know that, that as like he's saying, arises and dissolves billions and billions of times, this is goes to anatta or insubstantiality. What substantiality can there be that when we realize or when it is the case, as he says, that in a split second, matter arises and dissolves billions and billions of times? And so the idea is that our visual experience and our mental experience are the phenomenon of perception itself is a compositing of countless nano moments, phenomenal, you know, nano moments of phenomenal appearance. Appearance to arising, perishing, countless phenomena of appearance and disintegration in each second, in a split second, he said, matter arises, dissolves billions and billions of times. Now, I have not attained that, but I think I know what he's talking about a bit. And, I mean, it's very funny because he's really, he's talking about the one of the final realizations before complete and perfect enlightenment. I mean, this realization of, this is really anatta, actually. He's talking about a radical recognition of anicca, a radically incisive realization of impermanence, leading as the basis of a complete breaking of the third and, of the eighth and ninth fetters. Ninth fetter restlessness, eighth fetter conceit or identity, subjectivist identity, vijnana, atta, the belief in substantial separative selfhood. That's broken with a profound realization to this sort of epistemological or phenomenological insight, the nature of phenomena is not only radically impermanent, but it's thus insubstantial or selfless or without any identity at all. And that the matter arises is rupa. Is nama and rupa really different? Initially, he makes a distinction or talks of the distinction. But I think that there's, and again, I don't know what he knows, but I believe that he's making the distinction because later one realizes that that distinction also is a thought or perception that arises, that is continual, that is born of this unending compositing, this infinitesimally, this near infinite compositing of momentary nano phenomena arising and passing away. I mean, what the heck does that mean? In a split second, matter arises and dissolves billions and billions of times. We have an experience of matter, which would be what? The breath, the nose, where there's sensation of the breath, distinct from the nama, the naming, the mind, citta that's watching it. Well, that distinction would be recognized, but then the nature of the thought of the recognition, the belief that this is what I'm experiencing, that would be seen to be a composite too, and insubstantial as well. So thought is insubstantial, and therefore nama and rupa are also both anatta, and therefore, you know, the eighth fetter gets broken, and there's a realization. There is no substantial I to be found. Roth's talking leaving sixth density, right? We drop memory and identity. Same. So leaving higher self, leaving unified self-awareness, leaving the law of one, going to the law forever. It's not a law. It's really back to intelligent infinity. So anyway, he's identifying the higher wisdom, Adi, Panya, as knowing this, this fact of phenomenal, this phenomenological fact that there is infinitesimal and near infinite arising and passing away each moment of matter, which is really actually also of perception. What we call perception is a composite. What we call matter is a composite. What we call experience is a composite. What we call selfhood and identity is a composite. And when the mind, when there's this radical stoppage, when the mind is really quiet, silence of mind in a steady state, as Ross said, this is a radical development of that, of silence of mind. This is the far end of samadhi and stilling of mind, stilling of citta, right? Stilling the citta, as Patanjali talked about, radical stoppage of the arising of citta is a mind of the capacity for great concentration. And that's what we're talking about here. I mean, that's why he stayed in his hut all day, because you can't get to this interacting, you know, mindfulness, meditation, and daily life won't get to this level of profound insight that requires a highest intensity of concentration. And for that concentration, the mind has to be really silent and restless, the ninth fetter, very stilled. So, anyway, he goes on, in terms of practice, whether we're breathing in or out, there's always this air coming, going near the nostrils. And now he makes the distinction between mind and matter again. The entities touching, apparently, right? We have this experience of touching based on a conception of touching, based on a perception. Okay, there's air and there's nostrils, there's me and my breath, and there's the inhalation, the exhalation, all that differentiation is our, the fashioning, the composite, is the coarse level of the compositing of the experience. Because there's, again, like he's saying, this rising and disintegration billions of times in a split second. It's just like the movie. It's just like a movie reel. The moving picture show phenomena or experience as a moving picture show, as a composite of countless infinitesimal moments of appearance that immediately pass away, that when put to a certain speed equals apparently substantial experience and apparently substantial identity. But when the concentration is so great, as he is, one can see that whole thing stops, that the compositing stops. And, you know, then you get to Dzogchen, or you get to realization of emptiness, or anatta, the heart, a real anatta, or sunya, which, you know, is a complete attainment that I'm not aware of. I haven't had the experience of that yet. So he's saying the entities touching are matter, and the entity knowing the touch is mind. So knowing is mind, nama. What is being known is matter, rupa, the breath. Now that's just entry level, because beyond that, there's the deconstruction of the apparent substantiality of the thoughts, of the perceptions, of matter and mind. Matter and mind are empty too. So this is, he's really talking about emptiness, insubstantiality, anatta. And he goes on. When the air comes in, it touches. When air goes out, it touches. And this is another important point, which builds on the next point. This point here is, if you know this touch continuously, meaning if you sustain mindfulness means knowing this touch continuously, then greed, aversion, delusion, right? Grasping, aversion, ignorance, lobha, dosa, moha, don't have opportunity to arise. The fires of these defilements, ashrabas, subside. They don't go out, but they subside. And yeah, each moment of mindfulness is a weakening of the roots of these three unwholesome roots or poisons. Three unwholesome roots, grasping, aversion, ignorance, greed. Greed sounds like salivation. But we're full of desires. Here we are in Kamaloka, so of course we are. But everything we do comes out of a desire. Whether we know it or not, whether it's helpful or not, all action is impelled by desire. All decision is impelled by desire. And we know very little of the depths of the roots of motivation and desire, the full self-understanding of the nature of our desires. We don't know that at all. We know a little, not too much really. And then that's always associated with aversion. So they go together. They're two sides of the same. There's no desire without aversion. And aversion is always associated with desire. And the whole thing just keeps the moha or delusion or ignorance going, the avidya. So, but it's true, the longer one spends in mindfulness, the weaker the roots, those three unwholesome roots become. Then we have a little paragraph about knowing and temporality. You can't know the touch of air before it occurs. After it's gone, you can't know it anymore. Also, only while it moves in or out, you can feel sensation. That's called the present moment. But when you start thinking about the present moment, you're not in the present moment. You're in the awareness of the thought, seems to me. So that was always an issue in the in the commentaries on Anapanasati Sutta, the sutta associated with Anapanasati, and there were a few. When Gautama says, know the breath as long or short or this or that, what do you mean know? And then you have to find the original Pali for the word know. What is the word know? You mean manas? You mean buddhi? You mean something else? What was the word citta? What was the word knowing? The original Pali. What do you mean know the touch of air? Well, you can be aware of it, but that doesn't mean thinking about it. If you're thinking about it, you're in thought. Being in thought is not, I think, knowing the touch of air. It's thinking about the touch of air. So knowing and thinking are not the same. So what's the present moment? The present moment is a dream. In fact, it's all we have, and all we have is a dream. Dream in that its nature cannot be known by thought. You can experience it, but once you think it, you're in mental process about it. You're not in it. So then this is all, Buddhist epistemology. Is thinking knowing? If you think in the present moment, you can say, yeah, I'm thinking in the present moment. But how well are you knowing while you're busy thinking? So you can't know the past, you can't know that touch of air. This is the supreme subtlety of Anapanasati, it's really, I mean, any kind of concentration mindfulness practice. This is his breakdown of mindfulness practice itself, where the object is anapana, in breath, out breath. Mindfulness itself is very powerful and very subtle. It's basically being in the present moment. What? And even that is very unclear. You know, you see all these meanings, all these words have to be distilled down. You know, distill, what do you mean, being in the present moment? Being what? Thinking in the present moment? Well, I'm always thinking in the present moment. My mind is jumping happy-dappy all around, right? Well, that's not what's meant, I think. It's attentiveness. I think mindfulness as non-grasping attentiveness. Non-grasping means not holding onto it. What do you mean, holding onto it? Not thinking about it, I think. Not thinking about it, but being present. How can you know you're present if you're not thinking? I don't know. I can't think it. You know? I can't know. Can you know without thinking? I don't know. So then he gets into really strange areas. So he said, when we feel the touch of air, we know that there's only mind and matter. I don't know that. I mean, I'm not familiar with that knowing of feeling touch of air. For me personally, when I feel the touch of air or know the touch of air, there's just some awareness tied to the present, what seems to be the present moment of the sensation of breath moving. That's it. If I'm not thinking, I'm not thinking about mind and matter. I'm not thinking, this is my nose and this is the breath, nama or rupa, and this is me and my awareness, aware of it, nama. I am the nama with my nama awareness of mine, of the rupa of breath and nose and sensation. I'm not thinking about that. I don't think he is either. But he's saying, we know that there's only mind and matter. I think, again, like I said before, some of the people who came to him were working from other Burmese teachers' presentations regarding practice and the awareness of Namarupa, specifically teachings on Namarupa and practice. I've seen it in a couple of places here. So I think that's part of, he's trying to clarify that. But where he goes from attentiveness to the breath leading to the knowing that there's only nama rupa, mind and matter, is then that we know for ourselves there's no I. Okay, so anatta. So mindfulness goes straight to anatta. And that's the heart of what he's really saying, is that the insight of anatta or realization of anatta comes naturally by shamatha or vipassana, concentrative mindfulness practice. Mindfulness, samatha goes to vipassana. Mindfulness and some concentration goes to insight naturally. And I think that's absolutely correct. Or at least I have experienced something a bit like that myself. That there is a natural, I don't know about this recognition that there's only mind and matter, because that seems to me, I mean, I'm not aware of, yeah, you can say that, but I think the reality is much more subtle than there are two things called mind and matter. But yeah, this view that from that kind of steady, sustained mindfulness of the, you know, not the knowing of the deepened concentration on breath and the knowing of in-breath, out-breath sensation, naturally there's a movement to the recognition of anatta. We know for ourselves that there's no I, no other people, no man and woman. People just, you know, develop teachings along the way. Or when he says there's no man or woman, it's not like people in meditation are thinking, oh, there's no man or woman. Who knows? But there's always elaboration. And you gotta find the heart of the teaching of anything, anybody, me or him or anyone who has anything useful to say. The heart of what he's saying in this longer sentence here is that there's realization of anatta naturally by sustained samatha or mindfulness on the breath. We realize for ourselves what the Buddha said is true indeed. This is Sotapanna, first level. This realizing that what the Buddha taught or said is true indeed is breaking one of the three first fetters, doubt, in Buddha Dhamma Sangha. And realizing that there's no I is breaking another of the first three fetters, which is belief that views of selfhood have some value or substantiality. The empty, realizing that there is no... an initial understanding of anatta and the view, the realization that views of selfhood are all mistaken. This is where people naturally drop use of the word ego. And, you know... I would presume that people who have had Sotapanna don't play long with the word ego, like Ra, because they realize it's a wrong view to use the word ego is an implicit reification that there is a selfhood to be worked with, and Ra was saying that it's a third chakra blockage. The closest to what humans call ego is, in Rav's view, the third chakra blockage. A concept unworkable, work cannot come from it, or understanding cannot come from it. That's what they said of the term ego. So I think, yeah, the fetters are broken naturally by sustained mindfulness. And sustained mindfulness requires a pretty somewhat serious commitment to morality. At least... one can have some attainments in misery, in fire, but to go further, morality must be attended to. So, and he's saying, while we know in-breath and out-breath, in the moments of mindfulness, in the experience of mindfulness, there is no I or self. Absolutely. Correct. In my experience, too. This sense of I comes later. When we know this, our view is pure. It's right view. So right view as anatta. We know in that moment there's nothing but nama-rupa, mind and matter. He's saying that there's nama and mind awareness and there's matter and form, but there isn't a substantial selfhood. That's what he means is, yes, there's some kind of awareness, and yes, there's phenomena, you know, form-based phenomena called matter. There are bodies, there are forms, there are objects, that's rupa, and there is this awareness of them, yeah, that's nama, but there isn't an I to be found. He goes on, we also know that mind and matter are two different entities, meaning I'm not the table. If we thus know how to distinguish between mind and matter, we've attained to analytical knowledge of mind and matter. And this term is nama, rupa, paricetta, nya. And so, something like that. Analytical knowledge means knowledge based on thinking. Analytical means based on analysis. Analysis done by thought. So, actually, he's not talking about the final penetrations. He's talking about a preliminary penetration of the recognition that there's a distinction between mind and matter. Uh-huh. Okay. I think beyond that, there is a trans-analytical or non-thought form-based knowledge or knowing of the essence of mind and matter. Then, he said, and this is, then he's talking about benefits. And this is I'm quite aware of what he's saying. If we know the touch of air as and when it occurs, meaning or sustained mindfulness, the mind is pure and we get the benefits thereof. Don't think that the benefits you get thus, even in a split second, are few. Don't think that those who meditate don't get advantage from their practice. The benefits are not few. The benefits are great, actually, for mindfulness and then sustained mindfulness. They are profound, and they go through multiple lives. Because the mind learns by practice, by mindfulness practice, that there's a freedom from compositing possible. Freedom from compositing. The mind can know the nature of compositing. compositing is this ignorance-based formation of identity, and ignorance or avidya-based fashioning of the belief in substantiality, the substantiality of anything, the substantiality of perception and sankhara and vijnana itself, the apparent substantiality of the five skandhas are made by that compositing. And the mind learns its own nature as beyond compositing, if you know what I'm talking about. That's pretty weird. It's pretty esoteric. And that goes many lifetimes. That doesn't end. And that's the same kind of thing with Sotapanna guaranteeing complete and perfect enlightenment in seven lifetimes or less. It's not such a, it doesn't seem to be such a big deal to break the first three fetters, actually. But thinking about them is not breaking them. It's some kind of insight and releasing that leads to that breaking, as far as I know. But that leading to freedom from the octave in seven lifetimes or less, according to what Gautama said, is a pretty enormous benefit. And so the enormous benefits of Sotapanna, akin to the incalculable benefits of sustained mindfulness. And so more is better. And just the effort to develop concentration, non-grasping attentiveness, like to the breath, in breath, out breath, changes the mind permanently and helps the mind free itself from patterns of grasping and aversion, or cuts the roots of tanha and upadana, craving and clinging. The roots of tanha and craving and clinging that are associated with all the fetters, and associated particularly with the eighth fetter, conceit, identity, are significantly weakened. And this is stuff that you can't think about, meaning the levels of mind that establish the chains in the, you know, paticca samuppada, the dependent origination, the nidanas of craving and clinging, tanha and upadana, they're way before thought form. You can't think your way out of craving and clinging. It's way beyond working on emotional issues or personal psychology. It's that kind of stuff. Those nidanas are broken of craving and clinging only by radical stillness, which is ninth fetter weakening the ninth fetter heavily, which is restlessness, right? So the opposite of restlessness is stillness or stoppage, like Patanjali saying, you know, stopping the arising of citta, the movement of citta, stopping the subtle movement of citta, stopping vibration, radical stoppage. Gautama down the road saying, you know, this is the story, a very famous story of in the suttas, Gautama's life. Some highway brigand or someone accosted him and said, "Stop, monk." And he said, he just kept walking and, "Stop, monk." Kept walking. "Stop, monk." And this brigand wanted to assault him. That happens, I guess, in India regularly. Nityananda had it once with that. And Gautama just kept walking and said, "I have stopped." And that's stoppage of the you know, of rebirth in samsara, or rebirth in the 31 planes, which is a radical, complete severance, cutting the nidanas of tanha and upadana, craving, you know, craving, thirst, hunger, thirst, craving, and attachment, clinging, upadana, that leads to grasping, aversion, ignorance, or these three unwholesome roots. That breaking those nidanas of tanha and upadana can't be done by thought. It can only be done by a radical subsidence, subsiding of restlessness, or a very serious stilling of the energetics of mind, body, spirit. And that's where such high levels of concentration are possible, where he can see billions of times in split second the arising and passing away of light, actually, that is composited into a visual image and thought and identity. So it's seriously radical, and mindfulness goes that deep, or mindfulness can go that deep, or mindfulness, the benefits of mindfulness are very profound, if that can be said, are quite profound. Training the mind to be free of of craving and clinging way before thought form arises. So then we have some dialogue. Let's see what the time here is. 46. All right, 20 minutes. A dialogue with a disciple starts with Sayadaw saying, "Is the present time not auspicious?" And yes, isn't it so that people can attain their aspiration? He's just really kind of warming the guy up. Isn't it true that people with an open mind, can't those good people attain their aspiration for Nibbana who, with an open mind, receive and practice teachings of the Buddha, just like the noble people of the past who received the instructions from Buddha himself? Yes, of course they can. So the Buddha's teaching lasts 5,000 years. That's a canonical statement. So we're right in the middle of it now. What's the other portion in 4D positive? The human lifespan is 100 years. No one knows how long they're going to live. We're certainly going to have old age, disease, and death, right? Old age, sickness, and death, no doubt. We can't stop old age, sickness, and death. It's certain we're going to die. We're not sure how long we're going to live. However many years have finished, we're closer to death than ever before. And then, what haven't you accomplished? And he said, "I haven't accomplished the disciple happiness of the path and fruition states, magapala, the four attainments, and attainment of nibbana." And this is where, I would just make the point that it's okay to acknowledge that we're not looking to attain nibbana in any hurry. Does that make me unworthy to present his teachings? I don't think so. But honestly, we shouldn't pretend that we want complete and perfect enlightenment if indeed we don't live that way. So be real is critical. So he hasn't attained the four magapala, paths and fruits, of course. We haven't finished either. But he says, have you wasted your time? And he says, I have wasted my time. you can't really argue. I wouldn't want to argue with Weipu Sayadaw. I don't know if I would even dare approach him. But you don't want to argue with a guy like this. You say, no, I haven't wasted my time. I had some fun. He'll look at you like, you worm. Or something like that. But this guy doesn't know. This guy, is just a sincere disciple. And says, I wasted my time. I don't know, I don't think so. I don't think from higher self level. Higher self, of course, is not a Buddha. So from the level of higher self, experience is valuable. And like I've said, I don't think the purpose of creation is for souls to get out of it as soon as possible. So with different perspectives here. But again, Weipu Sayadaw is the teacher of get it done and practice is essential and don't waste your time. So don't waste the time you have left. Some people live long, some people live short. And then it makes an important comment about karma, that to be able to live that long, meaning some of the Buddha's great disciples lived over 100, to be able to live that long, we have to be full of respect for those who deserve respect and to be very humble. So full of respect for those who deserve respect is not full of respect for everyone. People who are liars, cheaters, frauds, manipulators, you know, serious harming, doers of harm. Should we be full of respect for them? You could be if you like, but I don't feel it. I don't think that, you know, I think that's not what he's saying. He said, full of respect for those who deserve respect. And that doesn't mean we, you know, self is a being of infinite worth. Yeah, okay, self is a being of infinite worth, or I is of the Logos, and that's of infinite worth. But here in time and space, treating everybody the same is unwise, I think. And then there are those who can truly help us and those who can't. And those who truly have developed wisdom and love and awareness more than we have. And that's who I believe he means are deserving respect, those who've developed green, blue, indigo, and all the virtues and concentrations and powers of mind, and know the path and know the way better than we do and have greater attainment. And people, and if we have that respect for the wise and the worthy, we will continue developing discernment, and we may well live long too. Of course, we may not want to live long in this world as it is today, but that's another matter. But longevity associated with rightful respect to those who deserve it, sincere appreciation for the wise and the worthy from whom we can learn and grow. Then paying respect to people. He says, yes, we pay respect. And then there's the issue of, well, you say you pay respect to seniors after you paid respect to the Buddha. But if I put money on the street, are you going to take it? Yeah. And what about if your friends are there, would you let them have some or grab them all and run for it? And this fellow says, I would grab all I could and run for it, sir. This guy is shameless, but he's honest. So he's honestly shameless, or honestly self-recognizing. I would grab all I could and run for it. And then Weibu says something very cute. He says, yes, yes, you fellows are not very pleasant. So he adds, and this is, again, I made this point that I've many times been shocked at the mind of the lay students around great teachers or teachers in Theravada Buddhist countries, at least. It's very surprising. Sometimes the greater the teacher, the more crude the followers. When it comes to money, you're unable to give it to anyone. you unpleasant fellow. Then there's a question about, there's some comments about dana, because he had made this point that dana is critical, generosity. If you pay respects to your parents, teachers, and those older, wiser, or of higher standing, without pride, then you'll live to be more than 100 years. Ba-boom, right? So longevity and rightful respect and recognition of those who deserve it, and those who are beyond us or greater. If you show respect for such people, will you get only 1,000? Will you only get money? It'll be more. Yes, indeed. And though you know what really matters, and here's that's the title of the chapter, and though you know what really matters, you wouldn't even give $1,000 to someone else, but rather you'd run and take it for yourselves? When the Buddha, out of compassion, taught the Dhamma, did everyone understand it? No, not everybody understood it. Why? Some people didn't listen, sir. So he's really saying, though you know what really matters, you sometimes may, or you here in the case of the $1,000 and the money on the ground, would rather run and get it all for yourselves and reject dana, reject generosity. So don't reject generosity, like don't reject Anapanasati practice, because the benefits are enormous and far more than financial. And he goes on, only if you take the teachings of the Buddha for yourselves. I mean, you have got to internalize these teachings. Right, of course, including the teaching of generosity and virtue. Only if you internalize them can you attain any type of awakening. And then there's different types of attainment. Perfect Buddha, Paccekka Buddha, meaning a private or solitary awakened one. chief disciple, great disciple, ordinary arhant. Not too bad to be an arhant. Not too bad to be an ordinary arhant. If you want that, you can. You can attain happiness now. Happiness will stay with you in the future. And so, about planting seeds. If you keep the seed, but don't plant it, it won't grow. So, put these teachings into practice. He said, only if you accept the teachings of the Buddha will you understand them, meaning if you live them. If you learn how to live with the awareness of mind and matter arising, what do you achieve? And he said, the disciple who doesn't really quite know it said, you achieve vidya, meaning knowledge or awareness, you know, higher, on true understanding. If one lives without the teachings of the Buddha, what do you call that? It's a vidya. So this is just stock replies, but if you live your life with vidya, understanding of Buddha Dhamma, or really understanding of the importance and the value, the practice of sila samadhi, or virtue, morality, and concentration, mind development. And that includes accepting your pain or knowing your emotional process and psychodynamics, but not getting stuck there, not getting stuck in eternal healing and balance. Healing and balance is needed where there's wounding. Once the wounding is somewhat healed, one doesn't have to stay continually self-healing. One can go to freedom from emotional identification and freedom from the emotional psychology process. That doesn't mean ignorant of it. It just means not fixated only on it, as far as I can tell. So, what happens after a life full of ignorance? Well, you go to the lower realms. And then there's this very common issue, or an issue that comes up before. Where do you go when your mind is in a certain state? Well, dying in a certain state of mind leads to what? Well, it's not as simple as some people may think it. As far as I believe, you know, this is... Take each person's view with a grain of salt and figure it out yourself, as usual. There is the view that whatever your state of mind, that's where you go. If you die angry, you go to hell. If you die in love, you go to heaven. If you die thinking of the Buddha, you go to the Buddha. If you die, you know, speaking to Ram, you go to moksha or something. I don't think that where you go after you die is as simple as what your thought, mental, mind state is at time of death. Mind state at time of death has relation, but it's not complete determinant of what happens next. It much depends on your level of evolution of the soul and the entirety of the roots of mind or the tendencies, the seeds, good seeds, bad seeds planted during the lifetime. You know, how much of the three unwholesome roots, the three poisons, are in that mind during that lifetime? Particularly, I mean, even before, but particularly in the lifetime, the mind that is detaching from the body at time of death is a mind born of the identity of the lifetime, which has more or less planted seeds of greed, anger, and ignorance, or grasping, aversion, ignorance, right? So how much so? How much is that a mind that has cultivated hatred and aggression and resentment, or sorrow and grief and self-pity, or fear and terror and weakness and self-harm or self-blaming? Who knows? So all of that has something to do with where one goes after death too, of course. So the view here is a very simple one, to some degree, and it may just, you know, what a great teacher tells one student is not going to be the same as what he or she tells another student, actually. So that's the thing. What he says to this disciple is not the same necessarily of what he says to another. It doesn't mean it's not true. It means that some teachings are mostly useful for the hearer and not for others, who may be at a different level of development or in another condition. So the idea is, if you're paying respect to the Buddha, and meditating, because his mind is wandering, he'll go to the lower zones or lower worlds, really. So he has a whole life of paying respect to the Buddha and meditation, but he hasn't had Sotapanna. But because his mind is wandering all over, sir, at the moment of death, yes, he'll go to the lower worlds. Really? I wonder. I'm not sure. So, got to figure that out yourself. It's not good to be rigid, but good to find your own answers. So, discussion on the quality, three poisons, three unwholesome roots, greed, aversion, delusion. And this is the radical explanation. Greed or grasping includes any liking, being attracted by something, wanting is greed or grasping. Okay, so that's the radical understanding, that any mind state, any tendency of mind, right, klesha, ashrava, defilement, inflow, outflow, canker, any tendency of any desire is greed. Ba-boom. Even the desire for enlightenment is greed. Well, that's maybe poison to cure poison. But he's saying one who dies with any liking or wanting in his mind is said to be reborn as a ghost. This phrasing is said to be reborn as a ghost. The phrase is said to be doesn't necessarily mean will be. Is said to be reborn as a ghost is not the same as will be reborn as a ghost. He might have been making the distinction that it can happen, not that it will always. That dying with liking and wanting in your mind goes to hungry ghost. But again, you know, everybody wants, if you're not, you have to be finished with identity to be finished with desire. And if any form of liking or desire is grasping or craving, which, you know, it is, no one dies with it finished. So everybody goes to hungry ghost? No, not at all. No. It depends on the strength. It's the strength of desire. And so hungry ghost, petta, is an earthbound spirit. And that is not having fully finished the yellow ray shell. Like that. Then we have aversion or grasping aversion. Aversion as enmity. Anger, frustration, hatred, you know. Push it out. Get it away. And he says, aversion is the cause of your fighting. Aversion arises because you don't get what you want, and what you get, you don't want. I don't want to have what I have, and I want to, and I don't have what I want. I want that, but I don't have it. I have this, and I don't want it. Dislike is aversion. So liking is greed and grasping, and disliking is aversion or, you know, hatred. If you die with dislike in your mind, you're reborn in hell. Well, again, it depends on quantity and quality. But yeah, absolutely, the tendency of aversion is associated with the hell realm, naraka, gehanna, for you too. And so, reborn in hell, it's not a good idea. Rick Wiles on True News was saying most humans, after they die, they go to hell. That may be some Christian view or not. I don't know about that, but it probably is, you know, in No Solar, they said there are thousands of those cities. Okay, thousands. Well, if there are 7.5 billion humans, and there are thousands of cities of thousands, I can't do the math right now, but that doesn't necessarily mean there are billions of souls in at that level of the astral plane. Thousands of thousands is millions of millions. I don't know. 1,000 million? Are there? That's a billion. So 1,000 million, or, yeah, 1,000 million is a billion. Are there millions of thousands? Right, 1,000 million is a billion. There are, what, 7.5 billion, meaning 7.5 thousand million souls? Are there 7.5 million thousands of those of no-solar astral cities. If an astral city has 1,000 people, does it? I don't know. Are there 7.5 million thousand seven and a half million of no-solars, each with 1,000 people? Probably not. So, how many there are thousands of thousands. That looks like millions. Maybe hundreds of millions. But how many of the rest of the souls are not there? Where are the majority of the souls? Maybe it may well be true that majority of human souls go to hell after death. Yee. So that I'm not saying that's so, but if you'd have to do a deep dive into Francisco Javier, Francisco Javier and teachings of Dr. Luis about No Solar and the number of these astral cities, which is middle astral plane, it looks like, for 3D souls harvesting, 3D souls approaching harvestability. Not yet, though. How many are there? And well, if there are 1,000 people per, there could be 10,000 people in the village in that place, so then it's different. But I don't think there are 7 billion souls in No Solars, it seems. There might be 500 million, there might be 1 billion, but what about the others? So that's a strange matter, right? Are do most human souls do is it 60, 50, 60, 80%? Who knows? I don't know. 60% of human souls go to hell or become hungry ghosts after death? Yee. Well, that's why things would be so weird here or so bad. If 40, 50, 60% of the souls after death go to hell or lower zones or hungry ghosts wandering a bit between incarnations before they come back to human, it's no wonder things are so messed up here. That's just a very sobering thought, I think. So then this is the correlation between the three states of woe, three woeful rebirths: hungry ghost, petta, hell realm, naraka, and animal, with the three poisons or three unwholesome roots. Grasping goes to hungry ghost, aversion goes to hell, ignorance, moha, goes to animal, only in the most extreme cases. But indeed, it may well be that more than half of human beings die and become hungry ghost, or wander a bit, wandering ghost, earthbound spirit, or and or go to hell, lower zones after death. Yee. If that's the case, if that's true, it explains a lot and is a very sobering thought. So, okay, there's the correlation between those three unwholesome roots and three states of woe. And I think our time is at the end here. Let's just see. Oh, the chapter's at the end too. So, okay, there's the linkage there. And then, the final point is his recommendation to work hard. And so I'll read it and close on it. What Poseidon just said: therefore, work hard to bring the perfections, parami, the perfections of parami that you've accumulated in the whole of samsara to fruition. Be steadfast in your effort. Act as the wise people of the past did after receiving the teachings directly from the Buddha. They worked for nibbana. Knowing that you too have been born in a favorable plane of existence, nothing can stop you from working up to the attainment of the paths, fruits, and nibbana, four attainments. Practice with strong effort and with steadfastness, and make sure that not even a little time is wasted. Advise and urge others to practice also. Strive with happiness in your heart, and when you are successful, be truly happy. And this strong effort with steadfastness is the strong effort of steadfast mindfulness, not running around or thinking or lifting weights. It's steadfastly remaining attentive to the object of concentration. And go back again, 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 again to the object of concentration. So that's it for today. I hope that was useful. He's a great teacher. And I hope you're well. Take good care of yourself. See you next week. and good night.